I can imagine how it might have gone. The writer Mike Bartlett had done well, had had plays at the Royal Court and the Hampstead Theatre, the Almeida and the National, About the World Today. Had won awards by the armful, received glowing notices from proper theatre critics, such as Michael Billington. He had done well. And he thought to himself, now I'm going to have a bit of fun. So he took a bottle of Chablis out of the fridge. Maybe Mike doesn't always drink white wine, but he wanted to get inside the head of the monster he was about to create. He poured himself an enormous glass, downed it, poured himself another, then settled down at the kitchen table and began Dr. Foster BBC One. As Mike went on, he delved deeper into the darker, uglier corners of humanity, jealousy, betrayal, bitterness, greed, obsession, revenge, and he ran with them. The wine helped. He smiled a wicked smile as he wrote. Maybe he was cheating a bit, being unfaithful to himself, but how was he enjoying it? As was everyone else, even if some of them also suspected it was a little bit wrong. Millions of them, more than go to all the theaters. And Mike liked this too. So he came back for more, as cheaters often do. Only this time he pushed it further still. Surely he can't do that, or go there, he said to himself. But then he gulped down another goblet and chuckled a wicked chuckle, because he could, and he did. And the second series grew, in size and pace and almost physical tension, and utter preposterousness. Until the end of the penultimate episode last week, with Gemma Serene Jones pointing her car at Simon Bertie Carvel, now broke and broken and alone, then stamping her right foot to the floor. For a more thorough medical diagnosis of the final hour, visit Julia Rayside's fabulous episode guide. In short though, Gemma doesn't do it, death by Hyundai doesn't happen. She swerves at the very last moment. There's a lot of that going on in the episode, swerving at the last moment to avoid death by other drivers, and by Mike Bartlett too. For now, Simon's down but not quite out. And with Kate safely out of the way, in France with daughter and parents, this can all be about them, the main event, Gemma v. Simon, in the final round, gloves off, no rules, most probably to the death. He would kill her now if he had a knife, he says. She is going to stab him, with the scissors, the ones from the title sequence presumably, except it's not him this time, at the door, but friendly new neighbors. Leave now, Parminster is not a good place to bring up children. Hell, kill himself, he tells young Tom. Poor Tom Taylor, he's in the ring too, collateral damage as he has been throughout, pinged about in the pinball machine of hatred. Oh God, please don't let it be Tom who gets killed, that would be genuinely upsetting. Simon tries a new tactic, they should get back together. What, well, they were happy once, cue flashbacks, happy memories, photos, a meaningful champagne cork. They're not going to, are they, have another over the kitchen island hate shag, they're not. Bartlett shows rare restraint. I'm disappointed. On the subject of kitchens, Gemma tells Tom they should get a new one. Because that is what 15-year-old boys are most interested in. Sorry that Dad and I have made your life hell and done permanent psychological damage, and that I wished you were dead when I had postnatal depression. That was the secret. But would an F-hob and new granite worktop help? Add all that must wait though, because Dad, Simon, is back on his suicide mission. No, not like that, says Gemma, pulling him back from the edge of the dual carriageway. Like this, and she leaves him the three syringes full of poison from her black doctor's bag. Ah, the loose ends are tying up nicely, however outrageous the whole package is. But then, after the worst breakfast in the world, she changes her mind again. Maybe don't top yourself after all, for Tom's sake. Where is Tom though? No, just gone, run away. As he should have done ages ago, it's his only hope. He'll always be here waiting, when you want to come back, says Gemma, standing in the doorway, doing her weird nervous right hand fidgety thing, looking straight into the eye of the camera. Whenever you want to come back. Well that's not closing any doors on a possible third series, is it? Don't do it, come back Tom, certainly, but also Mike B, it's been fabulous, and outrageous, and addictive. Enough though, I think a third, syringe, series, might polish me off as well. This article was amended on the 5th of October 2017. The headline was changed as it could have been construed as a spoiler.